So good morning. I do want to welcome everybody who is watching online. We're talking about the Bible study that we've been doing, that we did last week, and there is a lot of repetition. That is what helps us remember what God says. And so that's why there is supporting scripture for what we read, and then over and over again, it will hit home and it will stay with us. So there, for the week coming up, there are papers back there. Also, last week is back there underneath, but on top are this coming week. And we're in James for peace. And I will put that online on Facebook this afternoon when I get home from Walnut Grove. I will put that on there so those of you at home can follow with us. It's funny, I look up there like I know where I'm looking. I have no idea what camera I'm on or what I'm looking at. But I just want people to know that that we include them in our fellowship, in our because people are not comfortable coming out. And so we want people to know that we love them wherever they are. And so it is time that we share our joy, or share our prepare our hearts. My words haven't come easy this morning. It is time that we prepare our hearts, get ourselves ready to worship our Savior as Jenny plays the prelude. Let's pray. Oh God, we come into your gates with thanksgiving this morning. You are so good to us, and we are ever so thankful. Father, we pray as we sing your praises this morning that you are lifted up, that you are glorified, that everything we do and say brings you joy, and that you know how very much we love you. May the Holy Spirit have his way with us this morning, Lord. Fill this place. Amen. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, rescue me and deliver me. Turn your ear to me and save me. Be my rock of refuge, to which I can always go. Give the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Deliver me, O God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of those who are evil and cruel. For you have been my hope, Sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth. From birth, I have relied on you. You brought me forth from my mother's womb. I will ever praise you. I have become a sign to many. You are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise, declaring your splendor all day long. This morning, we light the candle of hope.
Our worship this morning is a song entitled Take Me In, and it goes appropriately with our scripture that we've studied all week and what Bev will talk about later on. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Stand with me.
Lord, I want to see your face. Take me past the crowds of people and the priests who praise their praise. I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found one place. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the my lips, here I am.
Sing it again.
Take me past the outer courts into the holy place, past the brazen altar. Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds of people and the priests who sing your praise. I hunger and for your righteousness, but it's only found one place. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take the my lips, here I am. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the Holy of Holies. Take the my lips, here I am. Take the coal, touch my lips, here I am. Take the coal, touch my lips, here I am.
Amen. You may be seated.
And the children may come forward. Good morning, girls and boy. It's good to see all of you. It's good to see Lily and Mackenzie. Nice to have you back with us. And we're just always glad when people show up, aren't we? We don't care when, where, how, just come and be with us. We're excited about that. So today we're going to talk about something really exciting. We're going to talk about waiting. Waiting. We all have to wait sometimes, don't we? Is that hard for you? Huh? Yeah, sometimes. Some things are harder to wait for than others. Like when you're in the car and the light turns red and you have to wait for it to turn green, that's not so hard to wait for. But when you're getting ready to go to Disney World or your birthday, then it seems like it takes forever. You wait and wait and wait. Until you get my age, your birthdays come around really fast. And they just keep coming and coming. Yeah. Maybe you guys have experienced that already. You are getting older. So I have a picture of something here. What is it, Lily? It's a puppy. And what's the puppy doing? Waiting for this little puppy has been trained to keep this biscuit on his nose. Or her nose. I guess I don't know for sure what it is. But he or she has been trained to keep that biscuit on her nose until the owner says, okay. And then he flips it off and eats it. Do you imagine that's hard for him to wait? Have you ever trained a dog to do that? Does anybody have a dog that does that? No? Joe's trained to teach her dog Zeke to do that. Yeah, sometimes it works. I mean, it has to really work. Wait. I mean, all he can think about is that biscuit. He wants it so badly. He wants it. And did he do it? So Lily had a dog. She didn't put it on his nose. You put it in front of him and said, wait. And he would wait for it. But you have to train him to do that, don't you? Just a good dog. Well, we don't have those in our house. Oh, really? He grabs everything. So that's his saving grace. There's always one thing a dog does that's really good that kind of keeps him, lets him stay around. Okay, that's good. I know you're close to your doggy. You have three dogs? You're crazier than I am. How many? Yeah, and you guys, Piper and Bo, you have two dogs, don't you? And cats too numerous to count. Yeah, but you live in the country, so that works out well. And you guys have two dogs and a cat. And you have three dogs and a cat. Boy, what if we ever had pet day here? My goodness, it would be full, wouldn't it? Bring my two dogs. Yeah. Andrea would bring her 13 kittens. She has five. Oh, really? Oh, my goodness. Wow. So you put a treat in front of the dog and say, stay. Oh my golly! Well, first of all, you'd have to be able to make a duck noise to do that. But so you show the dog a treat and make it stay, and then you hide, and then when he makes a duck noise, they go find. Oh my gosh, that's fun! Yeah, you guys are really bored at your house. No, that's cool. I'm teasing. That's fun. That is funny. I didn't know they did that. Which one does that? Both of them do. That's cool. Well, today we start a new season in our Christian calendar, in our the life of the church. It's a time of waiting, and it's a time of getting ready. What are we waiting and getting ready for? Christmas. Jesus. You're impatient? I think a lot of people are, you know. We understand that it's, you know, it's hard to wait for something as wonderful as Christmas. Is it the best day of the year? No. I think it's the best day of the year. And so during Advent, there are all kinds of special traditions and activities that help us wait and get ready for the big day of Christmas. Now, one of the things that we do to get ready for Christmas is the Advent candles that we have here. And so each week, there are four candles, three purple, hope, peace, love, and then the pink one is joy, and the white one in the center is called the Christ candle. So we will first light hope, and then we will light peace, and then when we go over to the pink one and light joy, and then we will come back to love, and then on Christmas Eve, we light the white candle, and whenever you see that white candle lit, you know the next day is Christmas. In case you forgot, you come in Christmas Eve, and you go, oh, tomorrow must be Christmas, the white candle is lit. But that's how we know, and that's our tradition in the church, that's what we do. So, get ourselves ready for Christmas. It's only like 4 weeks away. That's not bad. We don't have much time to wait. You have your shopping done? You didn't go shopping? No. Are you? Oh, yeah. I know. I won't repeat that. She likes to shop online. That's good. That's funny. I know, it is. Now, I've heard it's not a Good Friday, or Black Friday. I always call it Good Friday, because to me, the day we go shopping is Good Friday. The day that Jesus died as Black Friday. So I get those mixed up sometimes. But anyway, so Black Friday wasn't as busy because it's been spread out a little bit. So I don't know. Maybe your mom should give it a shot this year. Might not be as busy because everybody's staying home and shopping online. Anyways, it's an exciting time of the year. It's fun looking at the Christmas tree and the nativity scene, and it just reminds us of how much Jesus loves us. Okay, so let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for this special time of the year. Help us to be patient during Advent. And bless us as we wait for your birth. Amen. We have many prayers to share with you this morning. Teresa from Walnut Grove is feeling better, and so far nobody in her family has gotten it from her. Tony's grandson, Jonathan, that would be her son Brent's son, Brent that had just passed away, was in a four-wheeler accident. He has some broken ribs, broken collarbone, and some other injuries. Please keep him in your prayer as he recuperates from those painful things. No surgery was needed, but it sounds like some pain is involved. Donna's nephew, Bobby, keep him in your prayers as cancer has spread. We pray for all COVID patients. Or maybe we pray for COVID and for patients. No, we pray for COVID patients. Earlier in the week, I had sent out a prayer request for Corey, who had gone into the hospital emergency room with seizures, and they just really were not sure what was going on with him. And his fever is subsiding, and he's out of sedation. There's still, the last I heard, there were no set answers as to what had happened or what his recovery will be. Karen's brother-in-law, Mike, whom we had prayed for, has passed away. And so please keep Karen and her family in your prayers. There was their blessing, and probably many of you have this blessing, but Becky had shared what a blessing her family was to her at Thanksgiving. And it's a good time to remember that. I'm sure she feels blessed every day, but that just gives us that extra feeling. And I think that since my family wasn't with me, maybe I realized how very valuable they are. sometimes we take things for granted, maybe. And so it's good to be reminded to be thankful for our families and how blessed we truly are. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we take a moment in silence to, with the piano playing behind us, to offer up our prayer of confession to you. Father, we are so thankful that by the blood of your Son, Jesus, we are forgiven. That it is as easy as bowing our heads and telling you how sorry we are and to please forgive us and help us to be different in the future. We know that when we repent, you hear, you listen, and because of Jesus Christ and what he has done, we are made clean before you. We are found righteous in his name. We thank you, God, for that beautiful plan that you had and continue to have. We thank you, God, that you are ever so watchful of us, so caring, so devoted to us. And Father, we just pray that every day we become more devoted and more watchful or more committed to you. And we draw upon the power of the Holy Spirit to do that. Father, you heard the prayers of your congregation. Those who had COVID or have COVID, Lord, we lift up to you. We pray. And one I'd forgotten, God, was that Scott's grandpa, other grandpa, went back into the hospital. And so sometimes it's such an up and down roller coaster ride. One grandpa passed and a viewing and funeral, and one going back into the hospital, one getting better, and everybody who is involved in somebody having COVID that they love, it seems to be that way. And so, Father, we lift them up to you. In the midst of all the chaos that goes on, we pray that they just find a comfort and a peace in you. We pray for Bobby and all those cancer patients who just wonder what tomorrow brings. May they hold on to the hope that we all have in Jesus Christ. We pray for Corey, for continued healing and for answers, and for them to, for his body to be renewed. We pray for Karen and her family as she grieves the loss of a loved one. So many times in the paper I see in the obituary, Lord, I see because of COVID we will not be meeting. And Father, we need each other in these times. And I know we're all being careful, and we all understand that. But help us to find other ways to be there for each other. Help us to find ways to encourage and uplift each other when being in a physical presence isn't possible. Help them feel closure. Help them know you, Father, and to remind them that they aren't alone as they grieve. And help us to be the church that offers up ourselves to comfort. Father, you are always here with us. Advent season just brings you to our forefront even more than ever. But Father, in the hustle and bustle, we sometimes forget the reason for the season. And remind us over and over again, Father, that it is you, it is your Son. Without him, there would be no Christmas. Without him, there would be no giving and loving. And because, Father, everything good in us comes from you. We pray for those who cannot look or have a difficult time looking towards Christmas in a good way because they're not with their loved ones, or they're not able to provide, or so many things that come in. And Father, that's where your church should stand tall and just be ready and available. So place it in our hearts, move our spirit to be who you've called us to be. And Father, we pray all of this in the name of your Son, our beautiful Savior and Lord, Jesus. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes out of the book of Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 to 25. And for those of you that did the Bible study this week, you've probably read this a few times. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is, his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. Having our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching.
Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth. Help us to, you know, throughout our week, we gained lots of understanding on what this means. And Father, may what is said today just solidify in our hearts who you are, who Jesus Christ is, and Holy Spirit, and how all of you, how God in three persons works in our life. Make this personal for us, God. Amen. Therefore. That's how the passage starts out. Therefore. Does anybody have something different? Because there are other. It means the same thing, but therefore isn't the actual word. But then the different translations I read, it was therefore. And that word, therefore, ties what came before into what we're reading in 19 through 25. It's like, in conjunction with what you just read, I tell you this. Because of that, this. So what came before verse 19? Well, when we read all of chapter 10, one of the days that was the assignment, and we read all of chapter 10. So we read in verses 1 through 18, Christ is the sacrifice once for all. The law could not save us. Continuous sacrifices could not cleanse us. So we read in Hebrews 10:10, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Therefore, because of this perfect sacrifice in Jesus Christ, we enter with confidence into the most holy place. And we read in Exodus this week that the most holy place is where God dwelt. In the Old Testament, it's where the high priest met with God once a year. In the most high place, the high priest stood in the presence of God. Through Jesus Christ, all believers stand in the presence of God. We all stand in the most holy place. We enter into the presence of God, and we enter not in fear and nervousness, but with confidence as beloved children of God. With confidence, because we know of his deep, forgiving love for us in Christ. In the Old Testament, the curtain separated the people from God. There was the courtyard, there was the holy place, curtain, and then the most holy place. It would be like walking into the entryway, which was beautiful, by the way, if you noticed this morning. We walk into the entryway, and then that would be the courtyard, and then the holy place, and then there would be a curtain right here. This would be the most the most holy place. And somewhat, the high priest entered into this area only one time per year and stood in the presence of God. We get to do that all the time through Jesus Christ. The curtain of the old covenant has been removed. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And that enables us to enter the presence of God by way of the new covenant, through the body, through the blood of Jesus Christ. We read in Leviticus 17:10, "For the life of a creature is in the blood, and I have given it to you to make atonement for yourselves on the altar. It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life." Atonement. What is atonement? The reconciliation between God and you. The reconciliation between God and his people. The new covenant is our reconciliation with God through the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus is a great priest over the house of God. Only he stands between us and the Father. But he doesn't stand here and block your way to the Father. He stands in order to intercede on our behalf, and he stands in order to open the doors wide open so that we can have access to the Father, that we can have a personal relationship with him. Now, the remainder of the scripture, I don't know if you caught it or not, lists four duties of believers. First duty, draw near to God. Jesus Christ opened up the way into God's presence. He has taken our sins upon himself and bore the guilt and judgment of them for us. He is eager to present us to God as being sinless and righteous. Jesus Christ has made us acceptable to God. How are we to draw near to him? With a sincere heart. A heart that's genuine, a heart that's honest, a heart that's meaningful. A sincere heart involves an attitude of gladness and freedom and enthusiasm. Do you approach God with enthusiasm? As I read that, I thought to myself, you know how I usually, I start my prayer in the morning and I go, oh God. Now I'm sure he just goes, yes, my child. He's probably like, oh, what now? That's what I say when my children call me that way. Mom. So this week I have tried to talk to God with enthusiasm. Oh God, you are so good. You are so awesome. And I'm sorry for all those years I came to you with like, oh God. And sincere heart knows that what Jesus Christ has accomplished. That sincere heart knows the great impact and meaning that what Christ did for us, of what Christ did for us. A sincere heart knows that we can have the presence and power of God. That presence and power of God looking after us, caring for us every day. A sincere heart knows that God will deliver us from all trials and temptations and give victory and triumph over all. And boy, do we need that message right now. Do you have full assurance of our faith? We draw near to God with a sincere heart, with full assurance of our faith. Full assurance of our faith is having absolute assurance that Christ is the one who gives us access into God's presence. This is our full belief that Jesus' sacrificial death is the only sacrifice that God accepts. Romans 10:9 says, "Declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you will be saved." Romans 10:9, declare with your mouth. If you haven't said that to anyone out loud, I recommend you do that. His word says, declare it with your mouth. Can't be in your mind. Say it out loud, and no better person to say it to than your loved one so they know that you are saved. We can't let ourselves get fooled into thinking that we have access to God because we're good people. One of the things that will break a pastor's heart faster than anything is when I say, what is your, you know, do you know where you're going when you leave this world? Well, I'm going to heaven. And why is that? Well, we try to do the right thing. Breaks my heart. We can't let that fool us into believing that is where our salvation comes from, that we're good people, that we belong to the church. I had somebody tell me, well, I was confirmed. That's how I know. You know, I've never really done anything really bad. I wonder what they would think if I told them, well, I know people who have done things really bad, and they're getting to heaven. Because they have professed with their mouth that Jesus is Lord, and they believe that God brought him from the grave, and they are saved. I mean, all those things that we do are good. It is good to do good things, and we should live a good and decent life, and we really shouldn't do anything really bad. But those things are not what make us acceptable to God. Jesus Christ alone brings us into the presence of God. And we approach God with the full assurance that Jesus Christ is the sacrifice for our sins. But Pastor, you're confusing me. Last week you said that I have to help the poor. Last week you said to get my spot in heaven, I need to help the needy. I need to feed the hungry and clothe the naked. And what we're talking about today is having access to God. Before Christ died on the cross, before that curtain was torn, God's children had to go to a high priest to offer up their sacrifice for their sin. They couldn't offer their sacrifice. They couldn't offer the blood of an animal without the priest. And they had to offer sacrifices over and over and over again. They were never cleansed in a way that made them acceptable to God. Their offerings were continuous. We have Jesus. We have the high priest, one sacrifice, one time. When we accept him as our Savior, when we accept him and commit ourselves to him and bring him in as Lord of our lives, meaning he is in charge of our lives, we are made righteous. We can stand before God. We have direct access to God. We can have a relationship with God, the creator of all things, a personal relationship. And through that relationship, our hearts change. Through the power of the Holy Spirit given to us at our conversion, our minds are renewed. We are overwhelmed by God's love. And because we are so filled and overwhelmed by his love, we can't help but spew that out. We yearn to look after others. We want to serve God's people because of what he did for us. What we talked about last week in Matthew 25 is what happens after our hearts are changed. Remember I said, I took that little saying from David Jeremiah. I don't know that I told you it came from David. I told Walnut Grove, but I forgot to say it here. Good works is not the root of our salvation. Good works is the fruit of our salvation. It's what we're called to do and actually desire to do once we commit our lives to God. It was that moment that I understood God loved me unconditionally, no matter what I was doing with my life, that I felt that commitment of my life to him. He loves me so much. It all goes together in the kingdom of God. He brings us into his presence. We accept him as our Lord, and then we do for others. And all the while, God blesses us over and over again. Hebrews 10 goes on to say, draw near to God with a sincere heart, full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Picture the high priest cleansing and washing himself before he entered God's presence in the most holy place. He sprinkled himself with the blood of the sacrificial animal. He washed himself. This symbolized that his own sins were being forgiven. His own evil conscience was being cleansed, and the sins of his body were being washed away. The point is this. Before we approach God, we must be cleansed of sin and its guilt. We need to be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. We approach God through Jesus Christ, the only perfect sacrifice for our sin. Therefore, the only way we can be cleansed of sin is to trust Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross. If we really trust his sacrifice, if we trust in his sacrifice, and God accepts his sacrifice for us. God cleanses us from sin. He cleanses us and gives us a clean conscience and a washed body. And I'm so thankful that he does that every day, every minute that I need to be cleansed, it is done. Our second duty is to not let go of the hope we profess. We can't waver from our hope, but what is that hope? What is our hope? Our hope is the truth of the sacrifice of Jesus. Our hope is knowing that what Jesus did on the cross truly saves us from our sins, that it is real, that it happened, and that it was God's plan all along. That is our hope. That we are never without him. We can always come directly to the creator of all things. You are to believe that Jesus died for you. You are to believe that he arose for you. That is our hope. We block out the voices of doubt and false teaching. We stay strong in our beliefs. We stay on that foundation so trials and tribulations don't knock us to the ground. And we hold on to that hope because it's not in ourselves that we hope. It's not in our own sinful selves and our ability to believe or our ability to be good or our ability to do good works. It's not, that hope isn't rested on us. Praise the Lord. It is in God. Our hope is in God, a God who is faithful and perfect. We hold on to our hope in the one who has promised to let the sacrifice of Christ count as the sacrifice for our sins. And we hold tightly to our hope in he who is faithful. Our third duty, to spur one another on toward love and good deeds. To spur one another on toward love and good deeds. We are to encourage one another. Encourage one another to love and then to show that action, that love in action. We join together so that we can help the poor, the sick, the needy, the lonely, those in prison, the widows, the orphans. Oh, speaking of widows, I forgot to put Sue on the prayer list. I'm sorry. Sue fell the other night. She was going to paint her house, inside of her house, and she went to step over a bucket, and the bucket, if you can just picture this, the bucket kept going, and she pulled some muscles. So please keep Sue in your prayers. Sorry, where was I? The widows and the orphans. We inspire each other to love. We should be bringing each other up, never tearing us down. God has gifted Joe and I with different attitudes on different days, because the days when I'm like, I can't do this anymore, this is, oh, we give. There's, you know, and all the things that come to your mind. And Joe's like, God called us to this, Bev. This is what we do. I mean, he says that sounded sarcastic. He's not sarcastic. It's true. And you'll go, but, you know, we look at what we've done, and it's God said that, and God gave us this ability, and so then it's all okay. And those days when he's like, oh, Bev, how much longer can we do this? And I'm like, what do you mean? It's what God called us to do. This is awesome. So, you know, find somebody that can build you up like that instead of tearing you down. Am I off? Well, I'm almost done, so that will be okay. Oh, but they won't be able to hear me. So we build each other up, not add to the negative. We inspire each other in love. And that's the reason that we can't give up meeting with each other. That's our fourth duty. The church is the body of Christ. And the body works at maximum capacity when it is all together. When everyone is participating, that's how the body works best. Serving together, working together, brainstorming together. How can we serve our community? How can we serve in this weird time that we're going through? How can we be together when we can't be together? We get creative. I encourage everyone here, and I encourage everyone who's listening, to pray and to have a conversation with God about Hebrews 10:25. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Because, folks, the day is coming. Don't take my word for it. Read God's word. It's all over it. It's throughout God's word. He is preparing us. He gives us ways to get ready for him. Jesus has done and will continue to do his part. And it's up to us to do the rest. Draw near to God. Don't let go of your hope. Encourage one another. And don't stop meeting together. Let's pray. Boy, a lot of direction, Father, in that short passage. Your word is loaded. It is loaded. And I am just shocked every time I read it, God, that I just learn so much more. Because you are a big God, and we will never fully understand everything about you, but you have put your word in front of us so that we can learn more and more and more and get closer and closer to you. Thank you, God. Thank you that you have made yourself available to us through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen.
You know, one thing that stands out, and Scripture says this, and regardless of what side of the political table you sit on, regardless of what side of the religious world religion side you sit on, or world government side, Scripture tells us that Christ died once for all. For all. Regardless of what you might think, or your opinions that may differ, or attitudes that may differ from someone else, he died for that person. He died for all. Stand with me as we close, and let's sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
This is on. Now it's on, isn't it? Okay. Receive this blessing. In the season of Advent, may you have a renewed and exciting reminder of who your Lord is. And may you feel his peace and hope and joy and love as you draw near to him. Amen. Don't forget the pictures. And the Bible study in the back as you walk out.